Hello, I am Chauncey DeVega. You may recognize my voice from Ring of Fire Radio with Mike Papantonio, the BBC, Sirius XM, or the Tom Hartman Radio Show. And you may have read some of my essays at places like Salon and Alternate. I would like to thank all of you for listening to, downloading, tweeting, and sharing the eponymously named podcast known as the Chauncey DeVega Show.
And they ran a story by somebody named Chauncey DeVega.
Quote, I find black garbage pail kids, black conservatives, fascinating.
That's just unbelievable, you know.
He goes by the name of Chauncey DeVega.
You know, I've been called Uncle Tom, Oreo, sellout, shameless. But this is a new one.
Well, let's talk now to Chauncey DeVega.
As my man Chauncey DeVega of the blog We Are Respectable Negroes says,
I have author and blogger Chauncey DeVega here with us.
Hello there, good people and friends of the eponymously named podcast known as the Chauncey DeVega Show. I'm sitting here sipping my black cherry soda. Enjoyed a beautiful, beautiful day here in Chicago. Had to be 70-some degrees. Apparently it was warm, unseasonably so, all over these United States, especially in the Northeast. So I say take that, global warming deniers. Got a cool episode, David Weintraub, a professor, David Weintraub, talking about his book on religion and extraterrestrials. This is our Art Bell-esque, remember Art Bell? Man, I love Art. Talking about him all the time. Art Bell-esque episode, sort of mixing it up. So many fun conversations and topics to be explored. Oh man, I'm telling you, what a week. Went out and enjoyed that weather. Good episode with some political analysis. You know, this is episode 80-something-eth. Maybe I'll just keep it a running joke. We'll have a perpetual season 3, but I think this is actually episode 81. So where does the time fly? Always complaining about my schedule. I'm going to be energized by the black cherry. I love the black cherry. Let me have one more sip before I tell a little story. Get to this great podcast. But I want to share a little story because the personal really is political. So two decisions. So of course, having to decide whether to go to this Donald Trump rally is held here on Friday. I asked for press credentials. I did not receive them, or they're holding off until the last minute, but they'll do their due diligence, and I doubt they will let me in. I managed to obtain a ticket through other means. I'm going to be out there all day Friday. There are rumors. There's going to be thousands of protesters. Mama DeVega is telling Chauncey, don't go. I've had some good friends of the podcast email me and say, Negro, go to the movies and do something else. Maybe it's curiosity to kill the cat and intelligence brought him back, to quote the Munsters. Al, what's that gentleman's name? He had like two PhDs, got one when he was like 13. He played grandpa on the Munsters. He tracked down some of his interviews on Howard Stern. He also ran for Congress, I think. Al something. But, you know, sometimes you just have to go out of curiosity, and I'm not going to get in trouble. I appreciate everybody's concern. But when you got some wickedness afoot, I'm not 18 anymore, so I'm not going there looking for a fight. And even when I was 18, I wouldn't have done something like that. But I just think there's something to be said for experiencing a thing, seeing a thing. And this Donald Trump rally is either going to be a total and utter letdown because he's going to be on his best behavior, or it is going to be a hellacious you-know-what storm. A storm, a scatological storm. And you know, I go to places so that you all will not have to put my hand down in the muck, in the mire, the right-wing trough urinal, the political feces. I put on long gloves. I get the bleach. I get the ammonia. Don't put them together to blow up in your face. So I was very curious about white supremacists and how they were thinking about Trump. Because, you know, he had to publicly pseudo-disavow David Duke and some others. And I went to some of their websites. Because, you know, in the military, when you go to officer training school, I'm sure they have a version of it in the Army, but I know for a fact in Marine officer training school and combat infantry school, too, they tell recruits, these are folks who've already gone through basic, they're going to be officers, and they get specialized training. They tell them, turn the map upside down, which is a way of saying, what does your enemy see? How does the battlefield look from the enemy's point of view? And I use that tactic very effectively in online, real-time strategy games. Very, 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 very well, by the way. And it's really eye-opening, right? So you get out of your own comfort, and you say, what the hell is attracting people to Donald Trump? Why is Donald Trump doing the things that he does? And I know every week I have that website. I'm finding examples of hypnosis. I had that great one for Georgia Animal Steel. Next week we'll have Rasputin. Had Rasputin before. Because again, it's all about the hustle. So the media, and I go back and forth on this. Are they just irresponsible? And I don't know if I'm part of this. I don't know if I am part of the chattering classes. But he's the best thing going today in terms of rating and entertainment. But so much of this coverage is just so uncritical. Just watching the election tonight. Yeah, Super Saturday. Now we got another quasi Super Tuesday. a middling Tuesday where you had Michigan up for grabs. Mississippi, of course, Trump won there, and how CNN cuts away from Hillary to go to Trump because he's the ratings. And then you had that great piece I shared on the website at Politico talking about his antics. And I told folks this. I said it. Donald Trump is paying these protesters. And the dang story, he almost slips and admits as such. He's got corrals for the media. It's like they're embedded in the military, co-optated. Can't report the truth because, you know, that's when embedding happens after Vietnam. Because the U.S. military, the Pentagon decided they can't have reporters roaming around actually getting the truth. So you co-optate the interviewers, you put them in pools starting in the first Gulf War. Actually, I think going back to Grenada. And you sit back and they're manipulated. They sit here. They're not able to talk. They're not able to roam. And they chase that money. So I'm actually sort of happy. I'm not going to go there with a press pass. I'm going to go there as a regular person. But these white supremacists, they were saying Trump is going to Chicago. And of course, he's going to talk about being in Obama's hometown. Then he's going apparently down to St. Louis, where all that stuff jumped off with poor Michael Brown, Ferguson. And he's basically going to gin up white racial resentment. And that's what the white supremacists said. They were saying, well, white people who are on the fence will see what these quote unquote, I won't repeat their language, how they really are. The silent majority will stand with us. Trump is a genius because he's going to get the Black Lives Matter and other black people who are dangerous, crazy, natural brigands and criminals, biologically defective. These crazy ass white supremacists. We'll get me starting talking about Neanderthal DNA. That's a whole, I was almost going to go Afrocentric. In a fun way for a moment, but I won't. And that's what he's trying to do. So part of me says, don't give him the attention by going there. But the other part of me says, I got to see it. And I was talking to moms about it again. Don't go, Chauncey. Every time I tell you not to do something, something bad happens. Which is not true. I'm talking about confirmation bias. Like people looking for sharks. There's a shark attack. So sharks are everywhere. No, shark attacks are at record lows. But I'm thinking the Trump thugs, the brown shirt, hooligan mouth breather troglodytes, the syphilitically brained fools who are caught up in his Svengali glare, his glamour, are probably going to be the most motivated ones. Because who the hell is going to come to a Trump, as a pro-Trump supporter here in Chicago? And you got to remember that Chicago is one of the most segregated cities in the country. Dr. Kane talked about the Chicago suburbs. He said it was like going down to Alabama or somewhere. You got a lot of racists here in Chicago. A lot of them. A lot of racially resentful, bigoted white folks here. A lot of progressive white folks here, too. You're going to get him coming in from the suburbs and he's going to bust him in. So spark, flame, explosion. So the protesters will outnumber the Trumpers, the trumpeteers, the Trump thugs. But who knows? But I will be safe. I'm going to tell very quickly, as I said, sort of thinking about these elections, right? And we can do all the stuff about the data and Trump winning the Rust Belt and Reagan Democrats and the aggrieved white working class. And I'm going to be very careful in my observation because I'm working through the idea and I don't want to have anybody misunderstand my empathy for my white brothers, for all people on both sides of the color line, black, brown, red, yellow. But I don't, let me be careful here. I don't feel sympathy for the white working class. Sorry. And if I'm working on a piece about this now, all this, these narratives, New York Times had a great piece about Trump and race. Wonderful writing that encapsulated a lot of what we know about the data, about white racial resentment, about the percentage of black folks in a given geographical area and how that correlates to white racial resentment and backlash, the percentage or the areas in the South and some parts of the Midwest and other parts of the country where we had slavery, where slaves were owned, human black property, human gold, black human gold, and how that's directly related now to Republican voting. And there's an interesting spin, New York Daily News. Check it out. Track down that story. I think it was New York Daily News. Had a whole thing about the white working class and trying to understand their pain. I feel bad for anybody losing their home. I feel bad for anybody struggling to get a job. I feel bad for anybody who can't pay the bills. I feel bad for anybody who wants to be able to have a better life for their kids and they know they may not be able to. But it's just like this odd spin on white privilege because black and brown folk have been suffering far more. Black and brown folk have been disadvantaged so much more. Black and brown folk have not been supported in the same way by the submerged state. Black and brown folk did not have the benefit of what Ira Katz Nelson described as white affirmative action. So you have folks who are pissed off and angry because their wages of whiteness are not paying as much. So we're supposed to throw a fit to understand that they're not getting the same unearned advantages they once did. I'm sorry. I don't feel your pain. So I'm working on something. It's going to be hard to write out, but I always go back to my own humanistic vision, my own upbringing. Maybe I forgot what movie it was in. They talked about somebody went insane or somebody did something bad. I don't know. He was a villain or something in a movie. Not because he lacked feelings, but because he was too sensitive. And it really is easier, I guess, to live. Maybe that's where sociopathy comes from, collective mass psychosis. You know, thinking about conservatives and authoritarians and how they use the just world fallacy to ignore the pain and suffering of other people by saying, well, they just deserved it. It would probably be a lot easier not to care. And I'm looking, I got my Master Yoda figurine that was given to me many years ago by a lady friend I was involved. I love it when the lady friends give me things, offerings. Lady friend gave that to me. Beautiful Indian goddess who was a model. She blessed Brother Chauncey with a Yoda that she found at a Salvation Army. And I looked it up. It's actually worth quite a bit of money. So Master Yoda looks at me next to my it's not porcelain. I guess it's pewter. I got a pewter chimpanzee reading a book to remind me of my humanity and humility. He stares at me. But that's the reminder to always be honest. So I was walking down the street. And let's go back to what I said. The person was political. Maybe, like I said, it's easier not to care. So please forgive me if I'm not as articulate as I usually am. But I just saw this and it bothered me. So I was walking down the street in this nice day. And on the corner, there are these very nice, I guess, townhomes. I guess there's two in each unit. And I noticed that people have been moving some stuff out. They're very, very nice. And one day, a few months ago, 6 months ago, actually, there was a notice on the door that said eviction. And I was like, damn, another home, another person who lost their home. But then the thing was taken down. And I said, well, maybe they made the, went to court and they made the people get the paper. These bank gangster financier thugs, not interested in creating a productive economy. And, you know, during the Oscars, they had that great movie that won the Oscar, The Big Short. But there's another movie, if you just get a thing of whiskey, whatever your liquor of choice is, called 99 Homes. I may have mentioned it before, about the mortgage crisis and people being thrown out of their homes. This is a drama of great, great, great acting. Michael Shannon is in it. It's a tale about morality and choice and agency and freedom. Do you choose to join the devil, make that Faustian bargain? Or do you maintain your independence and your honesty and civility? But I was walking down the street, and your goodness, your ethical center. So I was hoping these folk were all right, because I was like, I'm hoping somebody stepped in. So I went out to get a sandwich at this new spot that opened up, and the service was horrible, by the way. They gave me a free, because I complained. And I said, don't you make me go on Twitter and smite you. So they gave me a free meal. So I cashed that in. And outside their house, their townhome, was the electric company or the gas company, and they had a black SUV. They had a manager with a flashlight. And this is like at 8 o'clock at night. Manager with a flashlight and all these people, and they're doing something to the meters. And I was like, they're turning these people's gas and electricity off, or one or both. And their neighbors are outside watching this. And people are looking. And I said, the place still looks occupied. And I was like, are they talking about, I know people got to do their job, but how do people do something like that? How do these people go and evict people and put their stuff on the street? How do you live with yourself? And it got me to thinking. And it got me to thinking about, you know, this voting, right? And that's why I say all this angst, all this pain among the white working class, the white poor. And yes, I understand as a political scientist, I'm supposed to tell you about how poor voters are demobilized. But like I've said many times before, this alienated white working class, and I think there are a lot of black and Latinos and others who are going to vote for Donald Trump. We have a system, I don't care if it's Hillary, Bernie is trying to do a little truth-telling, that has systematically failed regular people. It has failed them. And a lot of these people are going to be caught up in this sort of working-class authoritarianism because they want community. They just want a sense that somebody is speaking up for them. And if you look at that polling data on Trump, it's not his issues. It's that he represents a finger to the system from people who are pissed off. And that just scares the hell out of me. So I hope those people are okay. Thank you for indulging a little truth, because I know you all are sensitive people too. And people talk all this high-minded policy, but what are they doing for people who are hurting? What are these political elites doing? Think about Flint. These right-wing, mouth-breathing, troglodyte conservatives always love the Constitution. It's like they have sex with it. They make love to it. They're like a gimp for the Constitution. Got a gag ball in their mouth for the Constitution, but apparently there's a part in the Constitution they didn't read that talks about the general welfare. It comes up twice, if I recall from memory. Isn't having fresh water part of providing for the general welfare? Those people should be indicted, a bunch of criminals. But we're sensitive people and we care. What's going on? You know, we can go down the list. People being exploited at their jobs, unions being broken, student loan debt out of control is going to bring this economy down. People who will never get out of their student loan debt because it can't be discharged in bankruptcy. People being arrested now, apparently, by U.S. Marshals who have defaulted on their student loans. That's what we need to be talking about. I'm just really scared. We got all these hurting people in a society that they know, we know, is unjust in so many ways. It's no longer a democracy. It's a plutocracy. Go read Martin Gillen's work on this, or Larry Bartel's, about how the Congress is responsive to the rich. We know that, but now we got the data, and not to a we the people democracy. Let me have a swig of black cherry, but I got some fun storytelling for you too, once we get to this great conversation about ETs and aliens. Let me get my little swig very quickly here. But sometimes, like I said, this is therapy for all of us, because I know we're all thinking about this. Maybe that's how you have to get together. You got to change your own little corner of the world and look out for each other. Maybe the solution is people power. I know Occupy Wall Street is doing a lot of stuff with debt relief. Maybe we need to revisit the idea of having Grange associations, economic Grange associations. I don't know what that would look like, where we provide resources for each other, housing for each other, look out for each other. But I saw those ghouls out there at night, so you know what they were doing. And I almost wanted to ask them, we have people in there. You don't care. Oh, they didn't pay their bills. Well, maybe they lost their jobs. You know, think about how having this place vacant is going to affect all the other homes around here. Little Eichmann's. And that's another connection, too. You sort of think about the Reagan Democrat right-wing coalition that supports Republicans, that supports the Trumpeteers. Those are public union type people. The cops and firefighters and utility workers. Those are folk with a moderate amount of skill who can go and get a pension, make a lot of money over the course of their life, and you would think they would side with the people, but they side with the elites. And they're very, very, very careful in terms of protecting their skill. The skilled trades is a whole story. I'm actually going to have a guest on who's written a book about this. So there's a whole story about the skilled trades, whiteness, white privilege, race, and sexism. These white ethnics who have monopolized the skilled trades and public unions in many parts of this country will not let black and brown folk in. Those are their wages of whiteness. And they side with the oligarchs. They side with the oligarchs. I'm telling you. Sometimes I just wish I didn't know no better. You ever think about that? That's my working class affect. Didn't know no better. Maybe it's easier just to be caught up with Kim Kardashian's butt, admiring her big ass. It's not a particularly sexy ass. It is a nice ass. I will say that. But again, there's a whole thing with the way the black and brown women, black women, was a Venus Hottentot. Hottentot Venus, I always get it confused. How black women's bodies that look the same as her bodies were considered bestial and subhuman. But again, you can be quote unquote gifted with a big butt and have your mama record a porno video with you and Ray J with his big black dingus. And you can find fame. Stupid human tricks. So for the next segment, I tell you, sometimes we just switch it up. It's like a fireside chat. So we got the one and only David Weintraub, professor, Vanderbilt University, author of books on astrophysics, astronomy, book on Pluto. Is Pluto a planet? Great book that we're going to discuss. I said it's our Art Bell extraterrestrial show. We're going to have a few of these. Religions and Extraterrestrial Life. As I said, David is so cool. PhD, astronomer, Vandy. And we talk about aliens. We talk about popular culture. We talk about the state of science education in this country. Would he advise a president to make first contact? We talk about sort of, you know, the classic hard sci-fi dilemma if you're into science fiction. Are the distances too great? Are we all just too far apart in terms of space and time? Is the technology just not mature enough to even make this feasible? We're traveling faster and faster and faster, but it would still take a generation ship to get to the next solar system or the nearest solar system. Distance, man. The cold brutality of space. God. Order in the universe. And I would love to have him on again to talk about sort of the implications that we've learned now about these gravitational waves. He's a very, very cool man. Very patient, very kind, very intelligent. He has a sort of gravitas to his voice. So he takes me under the learning tree, this little ghetto nerd, and does some good teaching and explaining and educating about science. And as I said, those dang aliens who keep coming here and kidnapping people and putting stuff in their butts. Well, we didn't get to talk about that. I also didn't get to ask David about my theories about the moon landing. Ooh, the black cherry is making my melanin vibrate. But that's right up here. Next segment here on the eponymously named podcast known as the Chauncey DeVega Show. Aliens, religion, extraterrestrials / ETs. You know, ET scares me. A little pervert. I never watched that movie. It scared me to death as a kid. That pervert hiding out in a shed with that big glowing finger trying to touch people. Watch that movie as an adult. There's something that ain't quite right about ET. Ain't quite right about the brother. But that's the next segment here on the Chauncey DeVega Show. I do think you'll enjoy it.
This land is your land, and this land is my land. from California to the New York Island, from the Redwood Forest to the Gulf Stream waters, this land was made for you and me. As I went a-walking that ribbon of highway, and I saw above me that endless skyway, I saw below me that golden valley, this land was made for you and me.
As a scientist, as a man of science, what is your take on our current political scene, just in terms of sort of everything from global warming to, it seems like one political party is deeply invested in being against empirical reality? I mean, as a scientist, what's going on? Do you have any insights?
I find it scary. I think the people who are involved in our political discourse have trapped themselves into public corners, if you will, and they don't know how to move out of those corners. It's too politically important for them to stay where they are. They don't know how to move, and facts don't have anything to do with the politics. So we have these hearings in Washington over global warming that have nothing to do with global warming. They only have to do with politics. The facts are irrelevant. It's quite worrisome. Science is not part of the actual discourse. The way science is done is irrelevant. The idea that scientists have a political agenda is... Now, it's an interesting issue that ought to be discussed, but for the most part, most scientists don't. Most scientists are following where the data take them. And the data on things like what the climate is like is pretty overwhelmingly in support of the idea that the Earth is getting warmer. The only question is why the Earth is getting warmer, not whether the Earth is getting warmer. There don't seem to be any scientific facts in question about whether the Earth is getting warmer. And
yeah, I was watching that kangaroo court show trial, and I've done a few interviews where this has come up, because one of the things I repeatedly talk about is sort of thinking about the media, thinking about Noam Chomsky's work on concision, and how we got to this moment where you have the narrative of false equivalency. Both sides do it. And global warming is a great example. I think, you know, you're the expert. The consensus is like I was looking at some sort of summary that like 95 or 97% of the climatologists and other related experts say that, no, this is a fact. And it's only like 3% who put it in dispute. But if you have a TV debate or you have these hearings, you have one person pro and one person con, which totally distorts the scientific consensus. So the layperson is left confused and left to believe that these facts are in dispute.
Right. And this is part of the long tradition in how the media feel compelled to present information. So if you're a news reporter for a traditional newspaper or magazine or television show, the rules of the road are that you present both sides of the story. It doesn't matter if there are actually not two sides to the story, or that if the two sides of the story are not equally balanced, with 98% of the experts thinking yes and 2% of the experts, if they're experts, thinking no. You're required to have a fair and balanced story, which means one voice for each side. That's not a fair and balanced assessment of the information that exists, but that's the way the media traditionally has presented whatever the content is, with one voice for each side.
You know, there's a gentleman, I forgot his name, he's a white brother, civil rights movement. He's very, very famous, and maybe between the two of us, his name will leap back into our imaginations. They had a NPR, they have a Eye on the Media, I think that's what the show is called, and I try to listen to it every week. And it was the anniversary, it was basically around the time the movie Selma came out. So they were interviewing this gentleman, and he's basically known as the photographer of the civil rights movement. So he was a photojournalist, he would also write long-form essays. And he was there at Selma, he was in Birmingham, all these places, these iconic moments in the Black freedom struggle. And they asked him, they're like, well, how did you decide how to cover the story? And he looked, they were narrating it, and he said, well, what do you mean, to the interviewer? He's like, I went there to tell the truth. And he's like, the camera doesn't lie, we can manipulate images. And he said, And he said the same thing. He said, I don't feel an obligation to go interview Bull Connor. He's like, what was happening was so obvious in terms of who was right and who was wrong. I was on the side of human rights and dignity. And he said, if we were to cover the civil rights movement today, it would be the same. Both sides do it and trying to create a narrative where you don't have a clear moral frame. And he said, our media is in a real crisis.
Yeah, I agree with that. We think that fair and balanced, whatever that means giving equal time, equal weight to two opinions, two opposing opinions, even if the two opposing opinions don't have equal merit. And that just doesn't make a whole lot of sense to me.
Yeah, you know, I reached out to you, self-described ghetto nerd, grew up listening to Art Bell on the radio, and he'd have all these fascinating astronomers and physicists, people like Misha Kalku, theoretical physicist, watching PBS and Nova. And I heard about your book again about extraterrestrial life and religion, and I said, let me send an email out to the ether. And I was just curious. I'm always fascinated by people's personal journeys, you know, how they end up where they are, how their projects come into being. How did you end up working in the sciences and becoming, you know, involved in astronomy and physics? How did that happen for you?
I've never quite figured that out, to be honest. When I was a young teenager, I was growing up at the time that NASA was sending rockets to the moon, sending spacecraft to Mars, to Venus, to Jupiter. And that fascinated me. So I grew up in the space age. Lots of young people grew up at that time and did not become astronomers. So one did not automatically become an astronomer because one grew up in the 1960s and early 1970s. But I think that had an enormous influence on me. I did not grow up looking at the sky and looking through telescopes. That did not capture my imagination. I did have an uncle who gave me a telescope when I was a kid, but not because he thought I wanted to be an astronomer. He was a school superintendent. So he gave me a microscope also. And I never used the microscope. I thought it was boring. And I remember taking the telescope and setting it up in my yard and looking at the moon, and it didn't do anything, and I never used it again. I also flunked out of Boy Scouts because I was supposed to identify 5 or 10 constellations in order to pass my test to become a first-class Boy Scout. And I couldn't do it. Looking at the sky was not what interested me. But somehow, somewhere along the lines, I became fascinated with how the things in the sky worked. So it was the physics, the astrophysics of what was going on up there in the sky that interested me, not looking at the objects themselves. And then I think something happened to me that was, I think, a seminal event in my young education, which was that probably when I was an 8th or 9th grader, my high school produced a play. And that play is called Lamp at Midnight. And the play Lamp at Midnight is a play written by Barry Stavis, who did not write a lot of plays, but the plays he wrote were very historically accurate. And the play Lamp at Midnight is about Galileo and the trial of Galileo and why this astronomer got in so much trouble for saying the Earth orbits the sun. And this story about an astronomer doing science, doing astronomy, and encountering a tremendous amount of trouble from the Catholic Church, I think just got into me somehow. That this idea that science and religion both overlap and come into conflict has fascinated me ever since. And astronomy is a discipline in which we ask questions which are, at their heart, religious questions. Why is there a universe? How did the universe come into existence? The question about religions and extraterrestrial life comes from the passion that astronomers have for, at the moment, searching for planets around other stars. And in trying to discover planets around other stars, what we're really doing is we're searching for life in the universe. And we may someday detect life on other planets by studying these other planets. But the project of searching for planets around other stars is motivated by the desire to figure out whether we are alone in the universe. That's an astronomy question, but deep down below the astronomy question, this is a philosophical and theological question. Are we alone in the universe? What are we doing in the universe? What's our purpose in the universe? So astronomy and religion have this deep, deep overlap. And I find that incredibly fascinating.
I mean, those are profound existential questions. And, you know, I was talking to Frank Schaefer a few months ago. He wrote a great book. It's called, I think that one of, he's written many books, and I think the new one is called "An Atheist Who Believes in God." And he and I were talking about, as he said, he's a sort of that deep search for meaning. And I think, you know, we were going to and fro about sort of physicists, for example, theoretical physicists. And I'm very curious about sort of your insider experience on this as well. And he was saying, you know, theoretical physicists, if you look at the survey data about religion and public life, folks in the hard sciences, especially folks who work in that field, are not, they're less likely to say they're atheists or agnostics. But what they do say is they believe there's an order to the universe, but they don't believe necessarily in sort of an Abrahamic God. But after studying things like the unified field theory, or looking for that, or understanding dark matter, or just seeing the elegance in the world, there's some sense that there's order. Do you think that's common in your experience? I mean, in terms of talking to your colleagues about, you know, spirituality or faith or order in the universe?
Very few of my colleagues want to talk about religion. They don't, that's not dinner table conversation, or at least it rarely is. But I don't think very many of them would openly want to dismiss religion. At the same time, very few of them are likely publicly avowed members of any organized church or mosque or synagogue or anything else. I think religiosity and spirituality probably does go along with being a modern scientist for many, though not for all. When you look deeply at what you discover as scientists, there is a beauty. There is an order to what you see in the universe. And some scientists are going to look at that and say, that can't be random. There must be some intentionality to it. But a lot of others, I think, would be comfortable allowing the universe to create that beauty through randomness. So I don't think there is one shoe that's going to fit all for, you know, the vast majority of scientists. I think there are, you know, the community of scientists is just as religious and just as non-religious as most of the non-scientific community.
I don't know if it was Neil deGrasse Tyson who said this, the superstar that he is. You know, I'm also an atheist myself. I also think he's an atheist or agnostic, and he was talking about this very question about, you know, God and religiosity and order in the universe, and I want to get his quote ready. He made an observation akin to saying that, well, if God exists, he made a pretty brutal universe that's pretty destructive, and yeah, there's order, but that could just be math and matter and gravity. And so he said, no, I don't see any sort of fundamental evidence for an all-knowing, all-loving God if it exists. He said, probably the opposite. If he said, if a God exists who made this universe, he's pretty mercurial. Albeit very organized.
That seems pretty reasonable. All-knowing, maybe. All-loving, not obvious.
You know?
Right? The universe is, the word brutal might be a little harsh, but it might not be. The universe is a rough place. It's about matter being constantly converted from one form to another. And that goes for us life forms as well as non-living forms of matter and energy. It's a rough universe, but it's also a beautiful universe.
Going back to what you said about the space age, you know, my mother also is a product of the 60s and the space age. What do you think happened in America, you know, in our public discourse or maybe just our public life where we stopped dreaming about the stars and that moment passed? Was it just a function of the Cold War and the government spending billions of dollars to get to the moon to, you know, to beat the Russians? I mean, what do you think happened when we stopped dreaming about outer space? Or do you think I'm wrong, you know, with great movies like Interstellar some Gravity, The Martian. Are folks interested in the stars again, do you think?
I think the vast majority of us are interested in the stars and have been interested in the stars and have not lost that interest. What we've lost is the ability to afford to be interested in the stars.
Great point.
In the 1960s, we could afford to go to the moon, even though we actually couldn't afford to go to the moon. You know, we mortgaged ourselves to go to the moon because it was a military operation. We were trying to beat the Russians. So we spent an enormous amount of money to go to the moon. That wasn't money that we actually had, but we were willing to borrow into the future to spend the money to go to the moon. So we spent a lot of money and went to the moon. Now, I think it was a tremendously wise investment. We got a lot out of going to the moon, not just scientifically, but in terms of, you know, investment in products, spin-offs, unintentional spin-offs that have been very valuable. But we did not go to the moon saying, let's do this because there will be great spin-offs. We did it because we wanted to beat the Russians. We didn't go to the moon because we wanted to do great science. We manufactured the idea of doing science as an excuse. We didn't go to the moon to collect rocks. We went to the moon to beat the Russians. But as long as we're going to the moon, let's collect a few rocks, right? The same deal goes for the space station. We built the space station not because we wanted to do science. It was a big engineering project, and we wanted to establish a presence in space because that was important for, I think, fundamentally for military purposes, to develop rocketry and engineering to show we could do this. It was not a scientific mission, but as long as we're going to have a space station, we had to manufacture scientific opportunities and scientific reasons to justify spending billions and billions of dollars on the space station, and then we could pretend that it was a scientific project. It's never been a scientific project, though we have gotten lots of science out of having the space station. Other types of missions, like all the missions to Mars, there's real science there. The missions to Jupiter, the mission that's going on right now to Pluto, these are real science missions. There's nothing else involved in learning about Pluto or learning about Ceres or learning about Saturn other than pure science. These are great scientific investigations. And we have lots of satellite telescopes measuring the cosmic background radiation that are pure science. And these are much less expensive missions than human spaceflight. But human spaceflight is where the human excitement is. That's what gets people behind wanting to spend money on space.
Putting on our prognostication hats or thinking about the near or midterm, do you think there's a real future in sort of privatized spaceflight in the sense that you can go and get investors, get insurance policies? Because I think the first SpaceX, I was listening to a story about this. Again, always learning something new. Maybe this is why I'm not a millionaire or billionaire, because I didn't even know you could do this. So one of the ways the first SpaceX flight was financed was basically they went to there's types of insurance policies you can buy where you're basically gambling that something won't succeed. So if you succeed, you basically get, you know, it's almost like hitting the lottery and going to the casino. So they basically had this customized insurance policy. Somebody picked up on it and said, okay, we're going to bet you the $1 million that you're not going to be able to get this craft in near Earth orbit. Because the math says it'll fail. And if you happen to do it, we'll pay you out like 100 times what the bet is, in essence. And of course, it succeeded. Now, there have been many failures since then. But do you think like privatized, corporatized spaceflight, that's going to be the future?
I do. I think eventually that is likely to be the way that most space exploration will go. That's not where the science is, but already SpaceX and a handful of other corporations, Richard Branson and Virgin Galactic, if that's his corporation, they've already shown the interest, the financial wherewithal to get started doing this. There are asteroids that are worth mining. We don't know exactly which asteroids are the right asteroids, but we're not that far from having the ability to haul small asteroids into near Earth orbit and mine them and use them for manufacturing. And one small asteroid that that's rich in platinum and other rare earth elements is worth a fortune. And the incentive for going and collecting that asteroid is financially huge. I think someone will do it. Taking people into space as vacationers, there's big money in that. I think someone will do it. I think what we have to do is gather some political will to figure out how to control this before it happens, because once it happens, it will be hard to control. The idea that private enterprise will go to Mars, you know, there are TED Talks on this and people talking about this. There's some European company that said, we're going to go to Mars and we're going to take people to Mars, but they're not going to come back, right? This is the most morally, ethically wrong type of operation one could possibly imagine, that you could take people to Mars and leave them there to die. Yet, we are very close to having the ability to do that. There's no way that NASA, as a publicly funded operation, could take 20 astronauts to Mars and leave them there to die. We couldn't do that. But could a private company do that? Yeah, they could do that. Should they do that? No, they shouldn't do that. But they could do that. And if they could do that, will they do that? Yeah, they will do that. Because there are 20 people who would be willing to pay to be taken to Mars to die, because that just sounds so exciting and exotic, and they'll become historical footnotes.
Like, do they want to have like a Robinson, this is new to me, Robinson Crusoe adventure? Are these people who are billionaires who are terminally ill who just want to die on another planet?
I don't think they're billionaires, and I don't think they're terminally ill. I think they're simply willing to take the risk of being pioneers, and that they might not survive the journey, or they might not survive being the first colonists on Mars. They know that we can't bring them back, but they're willing to go with a spacesuit and a few supplies, and maybe they'll survive, but probably they won't. But they're willing to go and give it a shot, because historically they'll be the first ones to Mars.
A testimony to ego and narcissism.
Right.
To say the least.
Now, the way I think about it is, if 600 years ago, Christopher Columbus had gone to every king in Europe and every queen in Europe and said, would you please finance my trip off the edge of the earth? I want to go find the East Indies, and I want to sail around the world because I think the world is not flat. And every king in Europe and every queen in Europe had said no, would Christopher Columbus had ever sailed off the edge of the earth? Well, of course, Columbus did find a king and queen who financed his expedition. But if every ruler in Europe had said no, and if there had been a United Nations at the time, and if the United Nations at the time had said no, nobody is allowed to sail a boat to the west. It is forbidden. It is absolutely not allowed. Nobody may do that. What would have been the next thing to have happen? The next thing is, not only would Christopher Columbus have financed, somehow he would have found a private citizen to finance his trip off the end of the earth and discovered North America, which didn't need to be discovered since it was already there and there were people living there. But that's a different issue. But somebody would have financed it, but as soon as you say no, nobody's allowed to do it, everybody's going to do it, right? If you say nobody is allowed to read Harry Potter, everybody reads Harry Potter, right? As soon as you say you can't do it, everybody does it. So if the United Nations today and every world government says today, nobody is allowed to build a rocket and launch a private rocket to Mars, then I guarantee you that Richard Branson and Elon Musk and Spectre, right, James Bond's enemies, and a whole bunch of others are going to dig a hole in a mountain and go somewhere where nobody can find them, and they will build rockets, and they will launch their rockets to Mars because somebody said you may not do it, because we now know that we have the technological ability to do it. The ability to build a rocket and launch it off the Earth and go to Mars is in the public domain, and we're not that far from being able to do it, so somebody will do it. And saying that you're not allowed to do it won't stop someone from doing it. So what we have to do is figure out what the rules are. Just like we did with Antarctica a few generations ago, the world government said Antarctica will not be carved up by the nations. It will be international territory. And somehow we sort of have managed to keep to that, haven't we? We need to figure out how we're going to do that with Mars and the moon, because if we don't, somebody's going to go and plant their flag and claim it, and then we're going to have problems.
Yeah, that's exactly what, you know, you read my mind. I'm thinking of obviously a Spectre reference. You got Dr. No with a kitty cat trying to rule the world. But you said these private actors who may not have the public interest at heart, and you read my mind, as I said, because you have a lot of futurists, and I'm curious about what your take is on this, who are saying, you know, by treaty, you're not allowed to make territorial claims on the moon. But as we run out of resources on Earth, as we're probably going to have resource wars for sure over water, as global warming, you're going to have all the poles being exposed, get the resources there. What's going to happen when China, not even a rising power, a superpower, gets into conflict with the U.S. and the EU in Russia when they discover that there are deposits of minerals on the moon and people start claiming them, or asteroids? You could literally have another war in outer space over resources at home.
Which is why we need to get this figured out now. If we wait until somebody has already landed on the moon and fenced off a crater and said, the minerals beneath the Copernicus crater are mine, and if you try to land here and take it away from me, I will blow you out of the sky, the lunar sky, then we've got a problem. We need to have lunar treaties and Martian treaties, if you will, sooner rather than later, because probably not in my lifetime. I've only got, if I'm lucky, 30 or so years left. But in the lifetimes of my children and my grandchildren, by the end of the 21st century, we will have people on the moon, and we will have people on Mars. So figuring this out now is not too soon.
As we both look to the stars and our curiosities about extraterrestrial life, religion, how do you think it would actually play out? You know, that moment of first contact. Because one of the dilemmas that others certainly have gone back and forth on, and I don't know if it's even viable anymore given the ubiquity of communications technology and the ability to look at the stars and intercept radio frequencies and transponders and so on. What would that first initial moment be like when we actually make first contact? Do you think it would be one of those moments where you have to have sort of global elites maintaining the noble lie and they say, well, the public isn't ready for this for a variety of reasons? Or do you think it would be something where the genie is out of the bottle and there'd be mass chaos? Would it be either or both?
I don't think you can keep the genie in the bottle. I don't think there are any secrets buried beneath the desert in New Mexico or anywhere else. I don't think that's possible anymore. So I think as soon as somebody hears something, if there's something to be heard, word will get out pretty quickly. And there are lots of people who have spent a lot of time thinking already about what the protocols are for how to disseminate that information.
Because the UN actually has somebody, right, who's in charge of extraterrestrial first contact or something? I forgot the formal title.
Yeah, I think they might. I don't know those details. But there are a lot of smart people who have spent time thinking about this. And I imagine there are a bunch of people in Congress who think there are a lot of smart people who've wasted a lot of money thinking about this. But it probably is worth continuing to think about how we will handle this. I'm not convinced that this is an issue we probably need to worry about anytime soon. I'm a bit more of a skeptic on this than probably most of my colleagues, or at least a lot of my colleagues. But it nevertheless is a possibility, a reasonable possibility, though I don't think a likely possibility. So it's worth thinking about and being prepared.
Getting to the science about, again, thinking about, you know, life is common in the universe, but we have not had contact that the public knows about with extraterrestrial civilizations. Is it the old story of the vastness of space and the time and distances involved? Could it be, as some have suggested, that, well, any advanced civilization, if they survived and didn't destroy themselves, well, maybe they're in hiding. Maybe they know something that we don't know. Or could we just be alone? And we got here either too early or too late.
Both answers are, in some sense, equally reasonable. We have no information to make a reasoned argument that would help you go left or right when you get to the intersection of those ideas. All we know is, at this point, statistics. And even the statistics don't help you. The statistics we know now that are coming from astronomy are that when we study other stars, we find planets. We find lots of planets. A generation ago, all we could say was, as Carl Sagan was fond of saying, that there are probably billions of planets out there. We don't have to say that anymore. We know it. We know there are billions of planets out there. We haven't yet found billions of planets, but we know that when we've studied a few hundred thousand planets, we know we've already found a few hundred thousand stars. We found a few thousand planets already. And the techniques we're using should only have allowed us to find a very small subset of the planets that could be out there. Most of the planets should have escaped our detection. So the fact that we've found already 2,000 planets around 200,000 stars probably means there are a few hundred thousand planets around a few hundred thousand stars. In other words, almost every planet has one, almost every star has one or more planets. There are enormous numbers of planets out there. And many of those planets are probably planets that could host life. Life as we know it, meaning they're probably warm enough to have liquid water on them for substantial lengths of time. That doesn't mean there's life out there. It just means there are lots of planets out there. If there were not lots of planets out there, if planets were rare, that would suggest that life probably is rare. What we now know is that planets are not rare. But that doesn't mean that life is abundant. That just means planets are not rare, which means life has lots of places where life could exist. But that doesn't mean life does exist. So the next step, and this truly was the motivation for what I did in writing the book, the next step for astronomers, now that we've figured out how to find the planets, is that the next generation of astronomers will be studying the planets that we've now found. And during the next century, we will take this phone book that we have with the addresses and phone numbers of these thousands and thousands and soon millions and millions of planets, and we'll call them up with our telescopes, metaphorically. We will look at these planets. We will look at the light from these planets, and we will study the light from these planets, and we'll see if there's any evidence of biological activity on these planets. Now, that's different from waiting for a phone call. It's not ET phoning home. We're not waiting for radio signals with messages to come down to Earth. So this is not like the SETI projects, the Search for Extraterrestrial Intelligence projects. These are passive experiments in which we're simply studying the light from these planets to look to see whether they have oxygen in their atmospheres, to see if they have ozone in their atmospheres, to see if they have other signatures in their atmospheres that say know, George Washington slept here, that there is life in this atmosphere. There's no way, if you pointed your telescope at a planet like the Earth from the other side of the Milky Way galaxy, and you discovered all the oxygen that we have in the Earth's atmosphere, you would know there is life on the Earth, because this incredible amount of oxygen in the Earth's atmosphere is produced by life. There's nothing else that could do it. So if we found an atmosphere around a planet that was like the Earth's atmosphere, we would know there's life out there. We wouldn't be talking to those beings, whatever those beings would be on that planet. We would just know that there's a planet with life on it. And that planet might be 50,000 light years away from us. And if we want to have a conversation, it would take a long time, since it would take 50,000 light years to send a message one way. So we're not about to have a conversation with whatever it is living on that planet. And whatever it is living on that planet might just be algae or bacteria. But we would know that there's life out there. That's what's going to happen in the next century. So within 100 years, we will have studied millions of planets around other stars. And again, the statistical argument is all we're talking about here. If we study millions of planets around other stars, and we discover evidence of biological activity on just one, we know we're not alone. If we don't discover any evidence of anything we can identify as biological on any of them, that does not prove that we're alone, but it would suggest that it's kind of lonely out here, right? That there isn't a lot of life in the Milky Way galaxy. Even if there is some out there, it will be hard to find. We're still working on statistical arguments.
Here's an interesting counterfactual for our sci-fi fans, such as myself, and I presume you as well, mentioned in Contact, hard sci-fi, space operas, all the varieties out there. But the fun counterfactual, because that's why sci-fi is so great, because it allows us to speculate. So let's say we've developed, you know, I don't know, we can figure out how to make a wormhole or fold space so that we can close up those distances, at least for the purposes of communication, if not travel at some point. And I love that metaphor of the phone book. So dialing up these planets, and you're an advisor to a president, and he or she says, we found a planet that has artificial satellites, there are communications emanating from it, signals of all sorts of variety and type. And they turn to you and say, should we make first contact? Would you say yes or no? I mean, would it be too dangerous? Would you be afraid? Or you say, hey, why the hell not? I mean, what would the calculus be for you?
I would say make contact. That's what we're here for. To be part of the universe. And having evolved to the point at which we are able to discover that there are other beings in the universe, I would say that the obvious next step for us is to get in touch with whoever is out there. Yes, there are risks involved, but I don't subscribe to the idea that every possible civilization out there is a warring civilization and that we're all going to be taken away as slaves. I just don't buy it. There potentially is much to be learned from those other beings. And if they are so awesomely powerful that they can climb through the wormhole and come and take us all away as slaves, then they would have done it already. And if they're not that powerful, then we probably don't have that much to fear from them. But maybe we have something to learn from them, or maybe they have something they can learn from us. I think part of the argument that says to me, the Milky Way galaxy, at least, is a pretty lonely place, is the fact that there's no obvious evidence that we have been visited yet. I don't subscribe to the theory that Stonehenge was built by extraterrestrials. So assuming we have not been visited by ancient aliens or even modern aliens, then that strongly suggests that our part of the Milky Way galaxy, maybe even the entire Milky Way galaxy, is not chock full of other species who are much more advanced than we are. Because if they were, they'd be here by now. They'd be traveling through the galaxy. If you look at the history of human technology, and if you go backwards 100 years, we were riding trains. And if you go back 200 years, we were riding horses. Right now, we have rockets that can go at speeds of 30 kilometers per second. And it's easy to imagine that if we extrapolate forward 1,000 years, we would have rockets that could go at a few hundred, maybe 1,000 kilometers per second. These are phenomenal speeds, but that's only a factor of 10 or 30 faster than we can do right now. And if we can travel at 1,000 kilometers per second, then we will be able to travel at speeds that are fast enough to imagine building rockets and going to other stars, traveling between the stars. We can't travel between the stars at 30 kilometers per second. It'll take us hundreds of thousands of years to get from here to Vega. But if we can build rockets that can go 100 times faster, then it might only take us 1,000 years to go from here to Vega. Now, 1,000 years is a long time, but in 1,000 years, we will have longer lifetimes, and we will have different technologies. And one can truly imagine, in a sci-fi way of imagining, that we will develop ways of traveling between the stars. And one can imagine, again, if the UN said, thou shalt not build a spacecraft to go from here to Vega, well, someone will build a rocket that will go from here to Vega with some cryogenically frozen spores, and maybe that first rocket will fail, but the next rocket won't fail. And eventually, because we'll already know where the Earth-like planets are, someone will build a rocket which will successfully take some human embryos or spores to another Earth, and then there will be two Earths. And 10,000 years from now, those two Earths will become four Earths, and 100,000 years ago, those four Earths will have become eight Earths, will have become 16 Earths, will have become 32 Earths. So how long will it take before our civilization fills up the entire Milky Way galaxy? And the numbers are pretty easy to do. We're limited by the speed of our rockets, and our rockets are not going to become infinitely fast. But our rockets will become faster. And it's hard to imagine that if humanity survives for another 10 million years, we won't have colonized most of the Milky Way galaxy. I think that's actually pretty reasonable. 10 million years is a long time. That's, you know, the dinosaurs were around 70 million years ago. 10 million years is a long time. If we survive for 10 million years, we'll have colonized the Milky Way galaxy. So if some other civilization has a head start on us, they should be here. We should see them. And that argument, this is the Fermi paradox, that argument suggests that they're not out there, or that they're not much more advanced than we are. And if they're not much more advanced than we are, then if we contacted them, we don't have much to fear.
I mean, and that's the hopeful vision in another way, too, that we don't destroy ourselves, you know, that we found a way to solve our wars. We don't have some sort of extinction level event where, what is it, a few weeks ago, that paper, you know, certainly was written probably some time ago, but the general public became aware of it. The hypothesis about the dark matter hitting the comet, and that's responsible for extinction level events that happen on a cycle of every tens of millions of years here on Earth. But thinking about, you know, we did the president scenario, so drilling down into your book about religion and extraterrestrial life. How do you think the various faiths would respond? Would we have folks who are, you know, Christian evangelicals committing suicide, but you'd have other faiths saying this is all part of God's plan? What would the range of response be like?
I would hope we wouldn't have people committing suicide, though we already did have that. I don't know if you are old enough to remember the Hale Boppers, but we had, it was in the...
Now, who are they now? What was...
We had a comet called Hale Bopp in the mid-1990s.
Oh, I remember. Okay, yep.
And there was a small cult in California, might have been in Santa Barbara, I'm not sure where, but it was a small cult that believed that, you know, there were extraterrestrials riding on that comet, and their purpose was to commit suicide so their souls could go ride on the back of the comet or something like that. So, yeah, there will be some crazy people who do crazy things, but there are always crazy people who will do crazy things. I think if we actually established contact or discovered that we truly are not alone, that there is extraterrestrial life out there, I think most people of most faiths would embrace the idea. I think that's what I found for the most part when I looked carefully into the sacred scriptures of most religions. There are a handful of religions that at the present time theologically would have a tougher time. These are religions that have a stronger belief that life on earth is the be-all and end-all of God's vision and God's purpose. And those religions are, for the most part, conservative, fundamentalist Christian religions. Those religions would struggle with the clear discovery of extraterrestrial life, because that would confound that clear belief that God cares only for life on earth. Why would God have created life elsewhere? But would they then lose their faith? Would they commit suicide? I don't think so. I think they'd figure out how to deal with it. But it would force them to have to seriously adjust some of their beliefs. Would some religions go out of business? Well, there are always some religions going out of business. And would some new religions come into existence? There are always new religions coming into existence. So I think the answer to both of those questions would be yes. But that's the nature of human society, religions coming and going.
We started off with Galileo, right? And thinking, you know, would the religions, the more Christian fundamentalists, religions who believe that this is the be-all, end-all, that God, as you said, only has love for life on earth, would they have to convene a meeting and they would have to reinterpret scripture, just like the Catholic Church has had to do over time and have these, you know, gatherings, and they reinterpret and you discover new texts that were quote-unquote hidden before and now complicate the narrative? Or would it just be sort of lay people adjusting their own cognitive schemas to incorporate extraterrestrial life, and we would just be an asterisk? I mean, what do you think some of the approaches practically would be?
That depends very much on the structure of the religion. So the Roman Catholic Church operates under a set of rules in which a lay Catholic person does not have the authority to interpret scripture. And that was Galileo's problem. So Galileo, as a lay Catholic, was not permitted to interpret scripture. So just because Galileo thought scripture could be interpreted to be compatible with the earth orbiting the sun, he was not allowed to do that. That was the Pope's job. That was the bishop's job. So Galileo overstepped his authority in doing that. That was his crime. It wasn't his astronomy that was the crime. It was a religious crime in interpreting scripture in contradiction to the established interpretations of the Holy Fathers. That was the problem. The Roman Catholic Church still operates that way. So the Roman Catholic Church could simply convene a major conference of bishops, and they could decide this is the new interpretation. and then everything would be fine. And the Catholic Church, in some sense, has an easy path to follow, provided they can come to widespread agreement among the higher authorities within the church. If they decide a new interpretation is appropriate, then the deal is done. The Protestant churches operate very differently. The Protestant Reformation was all about allowing individuals to interpret scripture on their own. This was what Martin Luther wanted Protestants to be able to do. They didn't want to be forced to listen to what the Pope had to say or what the priest in front of the church had to say. Every Protestant should be able to read scripture on his or her own and interpret it on his or her own to figure out what it means. And as a result, in some sense, every single Protestant could have his or her own church, if you will. Now, lots of Protestants have banded together to form organized churches, and they have established their own rules for those organized churches. So, you know, the Southern Baptists have rules on how they want to decide to interpret scripture, and the Episcopalians have their rules, and the Methodists have their rules, etc. And they can decide to follow their rules, or a handful of Methodists could decide we want to break off and form our own church and interpret something in a new way, which is how all sorts of churches get established in the United States. So you drive down the street and you see church of something or other, and it's because 17 people decided to establish their own church. And within what are effectively the rules of Protestantism, which really effectively are, there are no rules to Protestantism except that anybody can establish any rules they want. Anybody can interpret scripture. So as soon as extraterrestrial life is discovered, if it were to be discovered, if somebody in, you pick the church, any church decides they don't like the way that church is interpreting and understanding scripture, they can move down the street to another church that interprets scripture differently, or they can start their own church. That's perfectly reasonable. And some churches may find they don't have any members anymore, and some churches may find they have a lot of members, and that's the marketplace of religious ideas.
All right, there's a really cool book to Jason Calavito. He's a professional skeptic and debunker. He has a great series, I mean, very, very popular website, where he basically deconstructs and takes on these ancient aliens hypotheses on the History Channel, all that good stuff. And he and I were talking, and I mentioned to him this wonderful book called Strange Histories that I happened to find at a bookstore some years ago. And basically each chapter is about, in this case, you know, how European religions, how they had to confront, focusing on the Catholic Church, how they had to confront certain mystical dilemmas. So there's a chapter in there, I'm a huge, you know, horror zombie fan. There's a chapter in there about how they would send out Jesuits to investigate claims of the undead, because if you had people rising from the dead, what does that mean about Christ and resurrection? Another chapter about, you know, they would investigate claims about animals seducing human beings for sex, because apparently in the Dark Ages, even up to, I think one of the most famous trials was here in Connecticut in the 18th century, about a man claiming his pig or his cow seduced him. They'd have to investigate that. Witches, of course, witchcraft. And one of the most interesting chapters was about, they actually sat down, some theologians tried to actually figure out how many angels could fit on the head of a pin.
Well, these would be, and one of the other, would be doctoral theses from 500 years ago.
Oh, it was a fascinating reading. You know, they're trying to do the math and what happens to somebody's soul when they die. Can we weigh it? Can we measure it? And so on and so forth. And they had another chapter in there about, you know, very related to what we're talking about sort of the obligation to convert, quote unquote, heathens. And if somebody doesn't know Christ's word or the word of God, do they go to hell? Should we change them? What should we do? So do you think there would be faiths that would say, aha, now we have a burden to evangelize the extraterrestrials? Or would they say, no, they're condemned to hell because they've never heard God's word? I mean, would it just be a, you know, a faith by faith case?
I think this is actually an important theological question, which I think some religions should seriously wrestle with now, in case we discover ET tomorrow. Because the idea that you should baptize somebody is connected to the idea that that person needs to be baptized, right? No sense baptizing someone who doesn't need to be baptized. Well, you baptize somebody if they require baptism in order to get to heaven, right? If they don't need to be baptized to get to heaven, then there's really no reason to baptize them, right? And if they're not sinful, then they're not in need of baptism. And the whole idea for Christians, baptism, is deeply connected with the idea of sinfulness and whether or not you need this sacrament, this blessing of baptism, in order to be pure enough to receive God's blessing to get to heaven. And for Roman Catholics, sinfulness comes from original sin. And original sin in Roman Catholic belief is something that occurred in a literal Garden of Eden that existed on a physical earth where there was a snake and an apple in the Garden of Eden. That's original sin. And the only way to inherit original sin is to be a human being on earth descended from Adam and Eve. So if you're not a human being on earth descended from Adam and Eve, you cannot inherit original sin. And therefore, there's no need for baptism if you're not a human being on earth. So let's say we discover an extraterrestrial on a planet orbiting Vega. They're not descended from Adam and Eve. So they don't suffer original sin. So there's no point in baptizing them. There are religions that have wrestled with this problem. This problem was pointed out by Thomas Paine 200 years ago. And there are a number of religions, and I discuss them in the book, a number of religions that wrestled with this problem in the 19th century because it's a serious theological problem. And Seventh-day Adventism was born in the middle of the 19th century in large part as a response to this very question. So the prophetess of Seventh-day Adventism, Ellen White, had visions in which she believed she saw extraterrestrials on Saturn, on other worlds, and the extraterrestrials that she saw were pure. They were uncorrupted by sin. She believed that the only sinful beings in the entire universe were humans on Earth. She believed in extraterrestrials, but she also believed that original sin belonged only to human beings on earth, and that Christianity was exclusively for humans on earth because humans on earth were the only sinful creatures in the entire universe because we had inherited original sin. And therefore, baptism would not be necessary for those creatures elsewhere in the universe. They don't need it. So Seventh-day Adventists absolutely believe in extraterrestrial life, and they believe that Christianity is only for humans on earth because we are the only sinful beings in the universe, and that Christianity is a religion that provides a way to absolve us of those sins through baptism, among other things. So there would be no purpose in baptizing extraterrestrials if you follow this idea that Seventh-day Adventists have.
I'm sitting here with a devious, mischievous smile, thinking about the Republican debates. It's like, I hope Ben Carson gets asked a question about that.
It would be interesting to hear.
I would love to see that.
My bet is that most Seventh-day Adventists don't know enough about their own religion to know this, that just as most Roman Catholics don't know enough about their own religion and most Protestants don't know a lot of details about their own religion, probably Ben Carson doesn't know a lot of these details about his own religion.
Wow, I learned something new. But we started off, you know, with a mention of pop culture as we wind down. What are some of your, you know, favorite movies that you think depict science in a proper light, an accurate light, or movies that deal with questions around science and space that are just entertaining, although the science is, as we say in the social sciences, piss poor. I mean, any favorites or least favorites?
I saw The Martian a few weeks ago, and I thought it was fantastic.
I did, too.
I won't tell your listeners much about it because they ought to go see it. But I thought the science in The Martian was extremely well done. I've now gone out and got a copy of the book so I can read the book to see whether what's in the book is as equally plausible and realistic as what's presented in the movie. But I thought the movie was great in terms of its scientific plausibility. What I like about science, I like the science fiction that I like best is the science fiction that's closest to what could be real. I taught a course here at Vanderbilt a couple of times on black holes and science fiction.
Cool.
And what I did during that course each time is we learned about black holes, the physics of black holes. But during the semester, we also read science fiction stories about black holes. And the challenge was for me to get the students to learn enough about the physics of black holes for them to be able to read the science fiction stories and assess the quality of the science in the science fiction stories.
And what's off the top of your head, what's the first mention of a black hole in a science fiction story that you recall?
Oh, I don't know.
I mean, were they being mentioned, you know, in the 30s and 40s?
No.
Was it imagined in...
No, I think they were first coming up in the 60s. But before black holes were actually discovered, they were being mentioned in science fiction stories. But the challenge for my students, what I told them at the beginning of the semester was, I want to discover from them which science fiction stories they like the best. The stories in which the physics violated the laws of physics least, or whether they didn't care. From my perspective, I have always liked science fiction stories in which the writer breaks the fewest laws of physics, so that I'm reading the story thinking, this could really happen, this could really happen, this could really happen. They didn't care. They just wanted to.
It's always about the story.
The best character development, the most romance. They just wanted a good story. They didn't care about the physics. Though they did get very good at assessing when the physics was unrealistic and when the physics was realistic. But they just wanted a good story. So they were very different from me. But for me, The Martian was both a good story, a compelling story, and possible, realistic. Interstellar. I thought that pushed the envelope a little bit too far. Some of it was good physics, and some of it was, you know, Kip Thorne's imagination gone a little bit too far for me. But it was a great deal of fun, and I'm very happy to have a lot of fun going to the movies. But Interstellar was not, from my perspective, realistic science.
What did you think of Gravity? Did you have a chance to see
that? I saw Gravity. I thought Gravity was pretty good. Most of Gravity was pretty good. I don't recall exactly what I thought at the time, but I thought there were a couple of glitches in there where, that's not quite right. But for the most part, I thought Gravity was well done scientifically.
You know, and certainly it's not science fiction, it's space fantasy. And there's soft sci-fi, too. There's a really cool book I always recommend to folks. Came out about 10 years ago. I don't know where the time goes. It's called The Physics of Star Trek.
Uh-huh.
And there's an accompanying one, The Physics of Science Fiction Films, and they have one about the metaphysics of Star Trek. And in The Physics of Star Trek, they have a whole chapter about, like, combat in space. And they're like, well, it's not going to be what you think, because you wouldn't be able to see the lasers being shot at you, or it'll probably be people throwing asteroids at one another or accelerating small darts that would shatter the other ships. And the ships wouldn't have to be aerodynamic. But again, it's all about the story, because I'm excited beyond belief to see Star Wars, which is certainly not sci-fi, space fantasy, next week, because the physics don't make any sense. You got the Force, the ships fly in ways that wouldn't make, the ships are so large that they wouldn't be able to get out of orbit. You have to build them in space.
Ah, but it's Star Wars. We're all looking for
it. But it's Star Wars.
Contact is one of the...
I was going to ask you, what did Contact get right?
Almost everything until the very end, and then it was Carl Sagan and Kip Thorne channeling their inner wormhole. So there was some weirdness at the very end, because that's how Carl Sagan wanted to write the story. But much of it the ideas on how astronomy works were pretty good. Now, nobody trying to detect signals is going to be listening with headphones at a telescope like Jodie Foster was. That's not how it's going to work, so that was a little goofy. But nevertheless, it captured a lot of the essence and the excitement of how astronomers do their work and the way SETI projects would be done. I thought it's a good movie for people to see.
Contact is one of those movies, I'm going to embarrass myself, it's on my list of books to read. I've never read the book, but it's one of those movies that every time I see it, I was in my teens when it came out, it has aged really, really well. And every time I see it, I have more respect for what they tried to accomplish.
Yeah, the special effects at the end are pretty good for when they did it.
Mm-hmm.
It's a good movie.
Solid movie. But Dave, I want to thank you. I mean, you took a lot of time out of your busy day grading papers, looking at the stars, writing articles and great books. Number one, as I always ask folks, what do you have planned for the future? Where can folks find you online? How can people buy your books, reach out to you?
Finding me online is hard. I don't have much of a presence. I have a website at Vanderbilt, but there's not much there. Now, my books are at Amazon. I've got the Religions and Extraterrestrial Life book. I've got a book called How Old is the Universe, which I wrote for my intro astronomy class, but I wrote it so that anybody could read it. And when I did it, what I said to myself is, what do I think is the most important thing that people should know about astronomy? And my answer was, I think everybody should know why astronomers think the universe is 13.7 billion years old. I don't care that they know that the universe is 13.7 billion years old. The answer isn't what's important. What's important is, why is it astronomers have the hubris to think that they know that answer? That's just crazy that these two-legged, six-foot-tall people on this little planet can claim that they know the age of the universe. And we do, and we're pretty confident about it. And what I try to do is tell the story historically of how we got to that answer. And my students keep telling me that they actually think the book is readable. So that one's out there. And then I have a book called Is Pluto a Planet, which, even though we now have the New Horizons mission out there with lots of new pretty pictures of Pluto, the Is Pluto a Planet book, which came out about 10 years ago, was motivated by the idea that it's hard to decide whether Pluto is a planet or not unless we know what a planet is. So the book is mostly a history book about the history of trying to figure out what planets are, which has changed a lot over time from the time of Aristotle until today. So the book is missing the last few years, but I think it's still actually worth a read. People can find it for a penny, or they can find it in their library, so they might go find it. Is Pluto a Planet. What I'm working on right now is a project on Mars. I'm not on Mars. I'm here. But I'm fascinated by a lot of the history of what we've learned from studying Mars. So I'm working on that, and I'm going to be looking for a publisher soon and see if I can get something to come out in the next year or so on that project.
Yeah, it sounds good. I'm certainly going to look forward to that. So any obligatory H.G. Wells or John Carter on Mars references in the preface?
I don't have one for you yet. But
maybe we'll sneak it in, yeah. Sort of a wink, wink to our fellow, our shared love of science fiction. But Dave, I want to thank you again for sitting down and chatting on the podcast. I learned a lot.
It's been a pleasure, Chauncey.
I want to thank David one more time for that great teaching and sharing. He gave us his own private grad level seminar, probably from his point of view, an elementary or first year college student seminar. But man, I learned a lot. And he's a plain talker. I was so impressed when he said, yes, I tell the president, make first contact, or the head of the UN, and there actually is an officer. I don't know if it would technically be an officer, but somebody with the title who's in charge of first contact for the United Nations. So look that up. That is not an urban legend or a myth. So I think it's a rotating chairmanship or rotating office. I mean, that's like the most boring job in the world, unless you believe in like Men in Black and stuff, and they're actually already here, but who knows? You're just waiting to give you the job as a placeholder. Because they're like, give it to Joe. Give it to Barbara. And then lo and behold, you get the phone call and you're like, damn, I wasn't going to come into work today. And now you have these huge decisions that you have to make. Man, that is not a responsibility that I would like to have. And that gets us to sort of thinking about these, like the noble lie and the lie that's told with ill intent. Like, you know, Obi-Wan in Star Wars with Luke, that's a noble lie. When he tells Luke, that Darth Vader killed your father. That's a noble lie. He's trying to protect somebody from pain. But think about, you know, why leaders lie, which is actually a really, really good book. So let's say you're a president or a premier or head of the UN or hell, head of the World Bank. I don't know. And you get the info that the aliens are coming. Now, I guess it would be hard to keep secret with all the telescopes that are readily available on the internet. But let's say you get privileged information. Somehow a signal was sent that was picked up. And you're like, do we tell the people and have mass mayhem and chaos? The country bumpkins, the religious fundamentalists who go crazy and start killing themselves and robbing, raping, and looting? Or do you just keep it to yourself? Or if it's an asteroid coming hit to Earth, you know, well, you can't do nothing to stop it. So do we just be quiet about it? Or will we actually have more panic when people are able to see it who have telescopes at home? I don't know. That is a hell of a question. Ignorance is bliss, but sometimes it's better to know. Watching, again, these returns over my shoulders, I said it's Tuesday. Dear Hillary Clinton, she has to make a calculation. Black and brown vote, we loyal to her, better for worse. I don't know if it's Stockholm Syndrome or not. But she given a speech and noticed something. She mentioned historically black colleges and white folk in her audience stopped clapping. Now, I don't know if they're just ignorant, don't know what historically black colleges are. They think, reverse racism. How come the black people have their own colleges? That's my sort of stereotypical white, racially resentful, ignorant voting voice. She talked about Tamir Rice. Now, she messed up there. Tamir is not a young man. He's a boy. You know how I feel about adultification of black and brown children. That's one of the ways that the white gaze and white supremacy kills us in the street. And then through the white racial paranoia gaze legitimates it. Excuse makes for it. Because, of course, little boys are adults and little girls are adults. And black men and women with wallets in their hands are holding guns. But, man, she got to make that calculus. Because black and brown folk, we going to vote for anyway. This chestnut checkers, folk. And again, I wonder, every time she says something, never mind Bernie, and them white folk in the audience, those Reagan Democrat types, the fence sitters at home who hear that, is it just one more person who's going to vote for Donald Trump or a Republican? So they tell the pollsters over the phone, I'm undecided, but they damn well know they're going to vote for him. I'm just trying to prepare folk for when they wake up and something goes down with this Donald Trump character. Because I think he is a lot closer to the precipice of the presidency of the United States than a lot of the pundit classes want to admit. So here's some fun. So I did some storytelling. I mean, not a little bit of a downer, talking about people losing their homes and having the gas and electricity turned off. But that's the world in which we live. This recovery is a false recovery, people. Yes, you have job growth, but what are the quality of the jobs? Yes, you can talk about you stopped the bleeding, but the limb has still been amputated. People are hurting out there. And that's that political energy that is driving this populism on the left and the right. You got Bernie mentum and you got Trump mania. Two very different phenomena. But coming from a lot of the same anxieties, and someone is going to harvest and channel them, and they could bring the system down, or at least shake it to its roots in a good way or a very, very bad way. The deep state is watching. When you have generals and former heads of the CIA again sending a signal they won't allow Trump, you better keep your eyes open. That's a very public signal about their intent, about what they're going to allow. But having a little fun, like I said, is our Art Bell fun extraterrestrial alien UFO episode. So anybody who grew up in the 80s and 90s remembers Weekly World News. I remember reading that, and it was so just compelling. If you're caught up in the sort of the Art Bell world before the internet took off, and when the internet was young, and all we had was AOL chat rooms and Yahoo, and you had to wait 30 minutes for a porn adult picture to download, but it was a good 30 minutes going on to chat rooms. Remember going to AOL chat rooms, Yahoo chat rooms, and some of the other ones? Mindscape? Was it Mindscape? I think they just finally shut down. And having cyber sex. Typing with one hand. Not that I ever did anything like that. I was just there out of curiosity. And that was also one of those formative moments too. You know, sort of my awakening, sort of understanding as a naive, young, black working class kid who thought that racism was a thing of the past because our parents are just so old. We're a new generation with new values. Discovering cyber racism for the first time on AOL. Discovering some of them chat rooms where they don't want no black people. Or they would tell you, you just start typing nigger, 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 nigger. Remember that? From AOL chat rooms? Learned a lot. There's a lot of great scholarship out there about cyber racism. I always tell folks, check out Jessie Daniels. She was a guest on the podcast. Check out some of her work. But you could find everything. And I remember sitting at that convenience store reading my Weekly World News, Bigfoot's baby, Bat Boy, JFK's alive, Elvis and JFK are hanging out, extraterrestrials, gay aliens found on Mars or in the Arctic, And whatever you think of Google digitizing all these books, and there's a lot of slave labor behind that, and I don't say slave labor casually, folks whose labor is exploited, it is very difficult work, and literally all over the world, I think apparently in South Asia, Southeast Asia, these books are being digitized, and these people are being paid next to nothing, so that we would have first world advantages, such as being able to look online and look up the weekly world news and all of their scanned volumes. So let me, you know, I like to read, but I found this story, and we'll put it up on the website, because I'm having a playful week. Recharging the batteries for Friday. I got C2E2 next week. I got a book party with a fancy dinner I've been invited to. I love a good fancy free dinner. Some parties I'll be going to next week. So, you know, I always try to write 2 to 3 times a week. Salon, Alternet is still republishing my stuff. Daily Coast, I'll tell you about that in a future episode. Is it Coss or Coast? I always mess it up. They can email me and apparently they'd be very upset if I'm mispronouncing a brother's name. And of course, the video podcast starting soon. And of course, the content on the website. So a lot of stuff going on. But these next few weeks, I'm just having some fun. So let me just have a swig of this black cherry before I read something. Because, you know, I like to share. And you're going to get a little smile on your face. Hold on. So I love that. That black cherry energizes. I still got that LaCroix soda looking at me, but I needed the black cherry to energize me after seeing people getting their lights and gas turned off. That's just my need. So Weekly World News has this great story. Let me find it on the computer machine. You hear me clicking. I'm getting old. I gotta put the glasses on. So they had a story, and I'm telling you, this could be Donald Trump, which is why I'm going to do the Photoshop and blow it up and put it on the website. Because I had the picture of the dog being forced to swear in to their Trump Fuhrer. That upset me beyond belief. So like I said, Weekly World News is always so much fun. I remember sitting there reading it when I worked at the convenience store, getting all that good information, laughs and smiles. I remember actually one night, sitting there at that Weekly World News on my lap, wearing my work jeans. You have work jeans, oh, too tight and old and raggedy. And this beautiful young woman came in. I was a senior in high school. And I was a freshman in college, and she had to be like a senior in college. And I just had no game. And she kept smiling at me, looking at me. Beautiful black sister, light-skinned, had a little blonde, looked like she may have been mixed race. A mulata. You know how Arnold Schwarzenegger loves the mulatas in Brazil? And she gave me her phone number, and I just didn't have the damn courage to call her back because I was stupid. How my life would have been different. Talk about all the different things that could happen. You go left, you go right. It's like chaos theory of some sort. I know there's a misapplication of chaos theory. So here's just a fun story. Just sort of just sharing and laughing about the Weekly World News. And let me tell you, Bigfoot sound like a better running mate and better for this country than Donald Trump. So I may skip around. But starting with the lead, Homer, New Hampshire. A member of Hillary Clinton's campaign team couldn't suppress his excitement when he recently confided to Weekly World News that the New York senator is not only running for president, but has selected a running mate in the 2008 race. Leading Republicans have threatened a wild and woolly battle in the upcoming election, and we've got just the guy to help meet that challenge, said Clinton advisor Don Key. The guy is none other than a towering wild man well known to readers of Weekly World News. We don't mean Bill Clinton, we mean Bigfoot. Sorry, I gotta laugh. Bigfoot doesn't intend to bully people, Key went on. He's very different from Donald Trump in that regard. His style will be a no-nonsense, get-it-done approach similar to Teddy Roosevelt, with a slightly altered motto of grunt softly and carry a big club. When told of the still-secret news, GOP spokeswoman Ellie Funt, I like that name, ridiculed the idea. That sounds like a Republican name, Ellie Funt. Good grief. How can someone run for vice president when he doesn't even exist? No one ever sees him except hunting prey in the wild or battling equally imaginary foes. See, that's not true, because Lady Bigfoot and Mr. Bigfoot, there were stories about them having sex with people in tents. They'd be sleeping, these men in the woods, and Lady Bigfoot would sneak into the tent and give it to them. But they said after they did it, she released a foul odor like she was scenting them. I remember that. I remember that episode of Weekly World News. I was saying, I'm never going out in these woods. Lady Bigfoot, get me. Continuing now. Reminded that this is how most people saw Dick Cheney, Funt stayed on message. Running Sasquatch is just another stupid stunt by desperate Democrats, she continued. Besides, the public won't vote for someone who stinks like a billy goat. Who'd come to those rallies? The red states, most likely, remarked Don Key. While shocking to many, the choice is not entirely a surprise. Political observers first became suspicious when they read about Bigfoot getting into shape. See, when Bigfoot starts getting into shape, you know something's gonna go down. He either got a girlfriend or he's running for office. The Bigfoot Diet, Weekly World News, January 1, 2007. They're on the game right there. On top of it. Johnny on the spot. It was obvious that his workouts and dieting were a preparation for some type of public appearance. Democrats are mostly enthusiastic about the potential candidate. Typical, is Washington State Delegate Ernie Furman. I'd be proud to vote for the old boy, he said. We got a lot in common. We live in the same area, we both hunt deer, and neither of us are much for going to barbers. I even forgive him for stealing... Bigfoot steals people's wives. I even forgive him for stealing my wife back in 65. After all, that was a hard winter, and it can get lonely up in the mountains, Furman laughed. I guess that would make him a natural politician, right? Oh, Bigfoot put on some of that Al Green, Teddy Pendergrass, and he puts it on him. Still, the Clinton camp knows there's much work to be done. Bigfoot will have to stop shunning crowds, kicking dogs who come sniffing his leg, and learn to be accepted into polite society. Donald Trump needs to learn about that, admitted Key. When he nearly crushed my knuckles, I knew we had to begin by teaching him a proper handshake, and we may have to rule out kissing babies. Not because he scares them, but because he attracts them like a big, live teddy bear. The last thing we want is video of a bunch of tots clinging to his fur while their moms scream in terror. Fortunately, once she's had a hot shower and a leg wax, his companion, the former Mrs. Beatrice Furman, will make a charming co-campaigner to her common law mate. Objective political scientists disagree about whether Bigfoot will help the Democrats' chance in the election. The public is tired of the same old sound bites and party lines, said Dr. Will Fairstate of the Green Mint Think Tank. They want an outsider to represent them. Since we've seen how a lumbering, semi-human creature with few verbal skills can attain elected office these days, Bigfoot should be a shoo-in. Not so, said sociology professor Frank Benjamin. Bigfoot has no credentials. No track record unless you count muddy footprints in a marsh. He doesn't have a snowman's chance, Benjamin added. There's also a problem with his legislative agenda. I've heard he thinks that litter bugs should be torn limb from limb. Yeah, sounds like a conservative. But they don't believe in the commons, so they don't have any problems with litter. But they do believe in punitive and excessive punishment for crimes, quote unquote. I'm reasonably sure that language will not be accepted by certain liberal legislators. Though ironically, the conservatives may warm to it. Of course, the big unanswered question remains. Why would this normally shy creature agree to step into the spotlight? Maybe Bigfoot's a patriot, I don't know. Maybe he cares about this country. Maybe he's disgusted by neoliberalism. Maybe he's upset about the plutocrats. That Bigfoot seems like a conscientious guy to me. So continuing, we first approached him with a banana and a platform that is heavily environmental, stated Key. Turns out he's very concerned about our vanishing wilderness, forests sickened by acid rain, and polluted waters. Bigfoot's smart. He's saddened that his once pristine home environment is degrading rapidly. I truly believe he'll rule the Senate in a positive way for 8 years in a Clinton administration, then go on to serve as our president for 2 terms, predicted Key. Can you imagine him negotiating nuclear weapons control with North Korea? I can even see the campaign slogan now, Key said. Give him hell, Harry. Little trip down memory lane. But as I said, I wanted a Weekly World News. I'm going to look it up. It's saying about Donald Trump. The robot, he's reincarnated Hitler, Il Duce Mussolini. But a lot of that satire is directly applicable to the campaign today, only 8 years ago. So as we wind down, next episode, that was fun. That was fun. I'm smiling again. Next episode, this is for the grown folks. Next episode, you may have seen her on the cover of the New York Times. Last week, here in March, I know I was in bed, the electronic version of the Times, and I was reading it. And I said, Lord have mercy, what is this world wrought? And then I realized it was someone whose work I have followed. On the front page, there's a beautiful sister with this white man and talking about their BDSM kink relationship. Now, the universe smiled on Chauncey DeVega because I have been trying to get her on the show for some time. So next week, as I said, this is one for the grown folk, not for the kids. We got the one and only Melina Williams, known as the perverted negress. You know I love the word negro and negress. She's a hell of a guest, man. She's a storyteller, BDSM educator. She was International Miss Leather 2010, Miss San Francisco Leather 2009, actress, travels around the country. And we talk about race. We talk about the color line. We talk about sex. We talk about her relationship and what's happened there with her husband. And how the public understands, misperceives, or misunderstands questions of sex and race. She was actually on, you can look up the episode a few years ago. She was on Dan Savage. She's just sharp and on point. And she and I did natural chemistry. Started talking, going back and forth, looked up, and it was 45 minutes. And then we said, let's talk a little bit more. So it's not one of those episodes I'm going to cut up. It is just what it is as a natural beginning, middle, and end. And we talk about race play. We talk about questions about love and intimacy. I share some stories, she shares some stories, and I tell her, I was like, you know what? I discovered your website when I put up that story on what we used to be called WARN. It still is. We Are Respectable Negroes / WARN / ChaunceyVega.com / Indomitable. About that slave plantations where a black man goes and he's auctioned off to these white men and they have their way with him. And the motif of the plantation is just what I said. It's a 19th or 18th or 17th century slavery plantation in the South. Probably 18th century, early 1800s. But that is one of the most viewed by our modest standards links on the website. Many tens of thousands of hits. Because, number one, I get emails from people saying, hey, Chauncey, I want to go to a slavery plantation. You have the hookup? And I'm like, no, I don't even respond to people. And you have other folks emailing saying, what sort of, you know, what is this? And I'm like, hey, I just find the stuff and share it. And that's how our conversation starts. Me and the perverted negress, Miss Melina. Talking about judgment, identity, sex, race. So as I said, put it on the podcast or drive around and don't have the kids listen to it because it is not rated PG. I say PG-13, soft R. It ain't an X-rated conversation. It's just for grown folk. So that is next week here on the Eponymous Name Podcast. It's the Chauncey DeVega Show. So as is my standard closer, if you like the podcast, if you enjoy it, if you find what we do of public service and value, as I said, where can you get the conversations we offer? You got professors, astrophysicists, astronomers, historians, political scientists, activists, journalists, Oscar-winning Hollywood types, folks who know about professional wrestling. I got a very nice guest for WrestleMania week, by the way. Hint, hint, somebody really cool. All in one place. That's what the fun of the podcast is. When I sat down, I said, I'm going to do this thing. I said, it's going to be eclectic and fun because there are just so many interesting stories and conversations everywhere. So if you like what I try to do, it takes me 3 to 5 hours a week, at least, sometimes more than that, if I got more than one guest to chat with, editing, producing the podcast, my other online work, ChaunceyDeVega.com, my other work you can find elsewhere all over these internets. You'll be seeing more of me at Ring of Fire, a lot more of me, and I'll leave it at that. I'm not compensated for the podcast. We do a twice-a-year fundraiser to help defray the cost of the podcast, opportunity costs, and the like, and I want to thank another kind friend who donated last week, Valhalla, to you, Mad Max reference, because they sent me some Mad Max love, too. So I greatly appreciate that. So you can go to ChaunceyVega.com, that PayPal link on the right-hand side. You click on that. Boom! Pennies, quarters, dollars, gold and silver is appreciated. And positive energy is always welcome. Please subscribe to the podcast in iTunes. Give us reviews. Write some comments. I'm going to keep nagging every week because it is so important. Greatly appreciate that. And as I always say, please, please, please reach out to somebody you've had a falling out with, a fight, a disagreement, some sort of pain. A friendship that went awry and you don't understand why. A meaningful relationship. It could be a love relationship, a platonic relationship, familiar relationship. Someone has got to send that first email. Someone has got to make that first phone call. Someone has got to send that first letter. And you've had that falling out. You've had that pain with somebody who meant something to you. Try to mend it. Have the high road. And at least you will know that you did the right thing. Because sometimes other folk, they're just not ready. They cultivate pain. They hold on to pain. They're miserable people, or maybe the hurt is just something that they can't get past, and they can't even explain why they feel that way. So just try to do the right thing. It's good for your soul, it's good for the universe, and you may very well be surprised. Please look out for our homeless, especially after that story I told you earlier, homeless semi-residence folks out there, people with their pets struggling on the streets, money, food, try to help each other. The weather's transitioning, doesn't mean people still don't need clean clothes and jackets, so you got some of those, try to help people out. Look out for human brothers and sisters, our animal brothers and sisters, our doggy friends, our cat friends, our winged and reptilian friends. We have a new octopus. I love octopi. Is that how you say what they are? Octopi? They call him the Casper octopus. Even he's so cute. They found him on the ocean floor. They better leave him alone. We know less about the deepest parts of the ocean than we do about outer space. Who knows? We're going to find them. Cloverfield monster may be down there. Gojira may show up, start whooping some behind. Gaia is not pleased with what we're doing to the earth. And as I always say, please try to be good to each other. Practice mental, physical, and emotional self-care. Spoil yourself. Spoil somebody in your life that you love, a friend, your child. Call up your parents and tell them you love them. I talk to moms every day. Some people don't do that, but talk to your people. Tell them you love them. Make the world a better place. And next week, the perverted negress. Hell of a conversation, folks. As I said, not for the kids. Here on the Eponymous Name Podcast, known as the Chauncey DeVega Show. As always, thank you for listening, downloading, and sharing. Be well and be safe. Peace.